This is the Galactic Emperor of the Universe, and of course I'm here to tell you to subscribe to Unrelent Gaming and all his social media platforms. Also, don't forget to turn on notifications so you can be the first to know every time that he uploads a new video.
Oh, did someone say Unrelent Gaming? Oh my god!
The fuck, Zarbon? Put on some clothes!
Well, why don't you put on any clothes?
What? I don't need clothes! Jesus Christ, that's huge!
Dragon Ball Super manga chapter number 39 is now officially in the history books, as right now we are going to further analyze, dissect, and break down the events of the latest Dragon Ball Super Tournament of Power manga chapter in order to gain a better understanding as to what is to come as we draw ever so closer towards the Universe Survival Arc finale, as we also begin to gain a better understanding as to how each universe is able to function as they battle for survival in the tournament of power. As before we begin, if you guys are new to this channel and want to be kept up to date with all the latest Dragon Ball news, information, and updates, don't forget to go on ahead and punch that subscribe button and turn on all notifications to never miss a single upload, as we kick off Dragon Ball Super manga chapter number 39 with Topo having to battle Super Saiyan Blue Vegeta. Now, based on the interaction between Topo and Vegeta, it looks to be a very intense battle because Topo seems to tear off his suit, he's battle damaged and dusty, fatigued, as is Vegeta, but just like Topo, we see Dispo, who seems to be down on one knee, Casserole's laying down, and the only person that seems to be unharmed and unscathed by the end result of this tournament is Jiren. While over on the bleachers, we see how the Supreme Kai goes on to state if they can hang in there and run down the clock, we'll win by default for having the most fighters left. As Beerus turns around and saying, "You think those idiots will think that far ahead?" As Whis goes on to state, "Indeed, given the amount of time left, the other universe's competitors will be unrelenting." So that sort of victory is unlikely, as Shin made the insinuation that perhaps maybe if Universe 7 can hang on long enough, they could win. While over out in the background, we get to bear witness to that of Super Saiyan Kefla versus Gohan. Now, a lot of people were very curious as to how, more or less why, Gohan is able to stand up against a Mega Fusion like Kefla, as the fight in and of itself, based on its overall design and based on the way it's portrayed, it's visually appealing and actually being able to see Gohan be relevant enough, at least in the manga, in fighting someone who's superior than him in terms of power. That ultimately changes as we dive deeper in the manga, but I really do enjoy the level of brutality that Kefla and Gohan offer, because every single time Gohan strikes Kefla, she dodges and moves out the way, tosses Gohan around, and begins to stomp down on his abdominals as she begins to taunt him and asking, "Ha, are you sure you don't need to go Super Saiyan for this? If you even can," kind of mocking Gohan and the idea that Gohan hasn't really transformed in fighting her to begin with. But then he grabs onto her ankles as he kicks her in the spine with his left leg, standing back up and saying, "I don't need that anymore." No need to, really, making the case in point that Gohan does not need Super Saiyan to defeat Kefla. And Goku overhears this as Kefla stands back up and saying, "No need to go Super Saiyan, why is that?" As Gohan replies by saying, "I choose to keep evolving as a human and not a Saiyan. I'm not relying on my Saiyan blood anymore." In which, back over on the bleachers, we see how Piccolo goes on to state, "That's Gohan for you. Regaining his sense of battle was all he could do in that brief period of training, but he's managed to grow stronger even during this fight." As Krillin is shocked by this and saying, "Whoa, talk about talent," makes you wonder if he can get stronger than Goku if he quit his day job and just devoted himself to training. As 18 replies by saying, "No one's quitting their day job, okay?" And Krillin's like, right. But he made the point in saying, just imagine if Gohan had kept this going in continuing this kind of training. The insinuation was made that perhaps maybe if Gohan kept this up, he could eventually even surpass Goku. And Goku's baffled, as were all of us, in watching this and saying, "Didn't know Gohan can fight this good." As he turns around and saying, "Looks like Gohan's got it handled over there, huh? Which means that we can focus on each other, Jiren." And Jiren looks at Goku kind of confused and saying, "Fight all you like, the end result won't change." Kind of making the insinuation that Goku, despite everything he can do, or at least attempt, he's just going to come up short in losing just as he did before. Which again, when looking at what Piccolo said, it's not only as an end result of Gohan having to focus more on his human side and growing stronger, but also he had grown stronger during the fight with Kefla, which allowed him to adapt in the long run. But then, we see Goku go Super Saiyan Blue, Jiren is in position to fight, and over out in the background, we see Topo and Vegeta really slugging hugging it out back and forth, and we see how they kick and punch each other so hard that Vegeta goes on to state, "Damn it, stronger than you appear," and Topo's huffing and puffing, but he goes on to state, "I am a god of destruction candidate," in which then Topo braces himself in powering up even further and stating, "And a potential god cannot afford to lose to a lesser being," and Vegeta smiles and saying, "Still have that much more power in reserve, do you?" as they continue their battle, but then we get to see Master Roshi and Android 17 squaring off against Dispo and Casserole, as 17 goes on to ask, "Well done surviving this long, old man," as Roshi replies by saying, "I'm not just going to lose to you whippersnappers too just yet," as 17 asks, "I can't read chi, but you're actually quite strong, right?" as Roshi replies by saying, could be, as Roshi goes on to state, "Well, what do you say? Should we take down those two together?" And 17's like, "Sure, they seem like the weaker contenders left." And Dispo's like, "Mocking us, will you?" So the four of them go into battle, and the only one that's walking around minding their own business is Frieza. And Frieza goes on to state, "While they've got all the nasty business handled, I can just sit back and recover a bit of stamina." And Beerus is really getting ticked off and saying, "Hey, Frieza slacking off. Who said he could just be a freeloader, huh?" As Whis replies and saying, "Keep in mind that it's all also in Frieza's interest that we win this. So taking a rest while a good number of fighters remain consistent is a valid strategy." And Beerus saying, "Guess I'll allow it then. Anyway, Champa using Potara practically counts as a violation. Good to know that you're as sneaky as ever, Champa." And as Beerus looks on over at Champa, Champa doesn't seem to reply. He just seems to be looking down, his eyes are closed, he's beginning to sweat, and that's when Beerus asks, "So what's this? No comeback? Got nothing to say?" As Whis replies to Beerus and saying, "Lord Beerus, it seems that Gohan and Kefla's fight is nearing its conclusion," and we see Kefla grabbing onto her ribs. She's huffing and puffing, she's tired and bloody. Gohan is huffing and puffing, he's tired and bloody, and Kefla goes on to state, "Haha, you look really beat up," as Gohan replies and saying, "Same to you." And Kefla doesn't seem to care, she's very cocky in her ability, as she goes on to laugh, but then she goes on to state, "We've lost, huh? Even fused, we couldn't beat a single Saiyan. There's just no measuring up to you, almighty universe. Well, it's our fate to get obliterated, that's just how it is." And it shocks me how Kefla even admitted that she herself, even while fused, can't defeat Gohan now. Which goes as far as to confirm that yes, it seems like Gohan is stronger than a fused Kefla in the manga. But then over out in the bleachers, we get to see how Universe 6 seems to have accepted their fate, because the Kaioshin is saying, "Oh no," as Champa opens his eyes and saying, "So, this is how it ends. Universe 6 did all it could." He stands up, and surprisingly enough, Champa says, "I appreciate everything, Vados." And Vados is like, "Lord Champa," as Gohan looks at Kefla and saying, "You're pretty strong yourself. And the truth is, I'm at my limit." And Kefla smiles and saying, "Ready to end it all?" And at that final moment, we get to see the conclusive battle between Gohan and Kefla as they rock each other with a groundbreaking, earth-shattering punch to the face, and Gohan having to punch Kefla, Kefla having to punch Gohan. They hit each other so hard that yes, as I've stated before, this creates a double elimination for both Gohan and Kefla. And Goku notices this and crying out, "Gohan!" And Gohan, as he's falling down into the void, says, "Sorry, Dad. You got this," right? As he finally disappears and ending up on the bleachers, and we then get to see how Kefla defuses, and at that given point, Krillin's like, "Gohan," as Beerus acknowledges this and saying, "That was a good workout there, spawn of Son Goku," as Champa looks on over at the girls and saying, "Good effort, Caulifla. Good effort, Kale." He stands in front and looking at Beerus, and everyone seems to be looking at Champa. Champa takes a deep breath and saying, "Beerus, this doesn't mean I've lost to you, so don't get the wrong idea, you failure of a brother." And that's when the Daishinkan cries out, "Universe 6 is eliminated," as Champa does his traditional Champa pose, giving the finger with the eye, sticking his tongue out as Universe 6 fades into an oblivion, and the only remaining member there is Vados. Vados looks on over at Universe 7. Universe 7 is very quiet as Beerus goes on to state, "A jerk to a bitter end, I see." As we go back down to the battlefield, Goku seems to be in hot pursuit. He's launching energy blasts, sending them directly flying towards Jiren's face, but Jiren doesn't seem to budge. And I really love the fact that even while Goku knows that he's going to lose, he still tries anyway. He's zip-zagging around Jiren, blasting him in the face continuously, and he seems to be doing this in a very precise order, as then he goes in for the punch and saying, "Take this!" And through the smoke, Jiren casually blocks. So you can make the argument in saying that despite everything Goku had done, nothing affected Jiren. Literally nothing, including hit. No other fighter was able to fully affect Jiren in this Dragon Ball Super Tournament of Power edition for the manga, as we get to see how Jiren casually blocks with his left, and he delivers a thunderous right shot to Goku's ribs. Goku goes flying through rocks, flying through craters all throughout the arena. He comes slamming against the rock. He seems to be in pain, and Jiren says the same moves time and time again. If that's all you've got, then this is a waste of time. Just allow me to end it. And Goku's really hurt. He's breathing and asking, "All I've got? Nah, this can't be my limit. There's still a wall that I have to overcome." And Jiren's like, "A wall?" And then we see Goku powering up more and more and more. Goku's blood pumping through his veins as he cries out, "Don't care if this wrecks my body in the end, because what I need now is pure power." And Beerus looks on over and saying, look, Goku's power just shot up. What's he up to?" As Whis goes on to state, you can say he's getting a power-up, drawing deep from his reserves for a temporary boost, regardless of what damage that might do. As Krillin turns around and asking, "Is this the same principle as Kaioken? The Kaioken now, after all this time? Will it even work?" And Goku even hits Jiren so hard that it doesn't really damage him, but Jiren is more or less surprised that Goku actually got a clean hit in. And despite what Goku is doing, he's trying, he's punching Jiren left and right, and Krillin's like, "Well, is it?" And Whis is like, "Well, I'm afraid not. He was mistaken. That was not what he needed to overcome his wall." And Goku's there, he's shocked because Jiren is grabbing onto his neck and saying, "Power gained by destroying your body can't necessarily be wielded properly. You made the very same mistake as that Saiyan named Kale earlier." And just casually smacks Goku off in the distance just with a casual punch. And Krillin's like, "Goku!" And Whis is saying, "This is looking bad. The wall Goku needs to get past may be entirely too high at this point." And everyone seems to be concerned, even Shin, as he goes on to state, "Meanwhile, that old fossil has his opponent on the ropes. He's about to claim victory." As everyone looks and we see Master Roshi fighting Casserole, and Casserole's like, "How could this be? I mean, every indication points towards your power level being low as a dirt, but why can't I hit you?" And Roshi's like, "Huh, that's what you get for relying on that doohickey. You ain't seeing what lies underneath." As Casserole goes for the attack, Master Roshi grabs onto his punches and then he casually eliminates Casserole. So just like in the anime, Casserole didn't really do much. As we see Casserole plummeting into the void, and Master Roshi goes on to state, "Better learn to watch your step." 17 looks over and saying, "Great going, old man." But then Roshi turns around and notices that Goku is just breathing hard. He's having a very difficult time. Goku begins to stand back up. He's shaking. His body is just basically wearing out on him. As Goku goes on to state, "Crude, there's no end to this guy's power. What do I do now?" And then Goku looks on over as Master Roshi goes on to state, "Hey Goku, don't tell me you're struggling." And Goku's like, it's my attacks. They don't even phase Jiren. And Roshi's like, "Sheesh. Looks like my old apprentice is still only half-baked. Goku, what's strength mean to you?" As Jiren walks on over and saying, "He is Son Goku's master, I'm assuming." Of course, Jiren knows. As Goku looks on over at Roshi and saying, "Strength? Well, even my Super Saiyan Blue form can't keep up with him, so I guess I need some kind of greater power?" And Roshi's like, "Huh, power you say? Plain old fighting strength? Who the heck taught you that? Vegeta? Frieza?" And Goku's quiet as Roshi says, "Nah, that's no way of measuring things. That's no way to measure things." And Goku's like, "I don't get it, Gramps." And Jiren's quiet because he's listening as Roshi says, "We don't master martial arts to win fights. We do it to conquer ourselves. Until you learn not to get all caught up in your enemy's power, you will always be as green as the day we met. Think of all your masters along the way. what they teach you. As Goku looks back at everyone, as Korin says, too much wasted movement, that's why you run out of breath quickly. Kami and Popo, be as tranquil as the heavens and as quick as a bolt from the blue. As King Kai states, wanna be the best in the universe? Then you gotta train, not just your body, but also your spirit. And even remembering Whis and saying, don't allow your mind to control your movements. Every part of your body must judge an action on its own. And Goku's like, Gramps! And Roshi's like, Goku, do you eat well, rest well, play well, learn well? And Goku's like, sure, well, I don't know about the whole learning thing, but... And Roshi's like, one last lesson from the turtle school then, on how to move well. And Roshi goes in as he attempts to attack Jiren, and the moment Jiren throws the left punch at Roshi, Roshi instinctively dodges Jiren's attacks, and Jiren is caught by surprise. Now again, we see how Roshi's able to fight back, we see how Roshi is casually just dodging Jiren's attacks, and it has nothing to do apparently with Ultra Instinct, but more or less being able to move well enough to avoid your opponent's attacks. It's not about power, it's about technique. And we see Roshi slip and sliding underneath Jiren, he's back flipping and moving away, and again, keep in mind, once again, as I've stated before, Jiren is very suppressed. If Jiren wanted to, Jiren could easily kill Master Roshi. Let's not get that confused. And no, originally a lot of us thought that Roshi did have UI. Roshi does not have Ultra Instinct, but the only difference here is he's able to move well enough by using his technique and not power. And we see how Goku's like, what the, Gramps? And Beerus is like, hey, Whis, those movements, are they... And then Whis is like, a strong resemblance, yes. And we see Roshi as he's fighting against Jiren. He gets grazed over his mustache. Jiren barely catches Roshi in the ribs, and Roshi notices this. As Whis goes on to state, a resemblance balance, yes. Still a far cry from that technique. And Beerus is like, thought so, yeah. No way that old Ku could master it. And Whis is like, still, with his age comes great wisdom. And it's a similar principle, of course, referring to Ultra Instinct. And Goku's like, how are you moving like that? And Roshi's like, tired. He's like, sheesh, I sure did talk big, but I've got ways to go too. Look into your heart, Goku. You'll find the answer there. As Goku, shocked, Roshi goes in for the final punch, and Jiren kind of gives off this very ominous stare. He opens his eyes, he glares at Roshi, he moves away, and just like we saw Whis do to Beerus in Battle of Gods, one simple chop to the back of the neck, and it's over. Owarida. One single chop, and Roshi has been eliminated by Jiren. And at that given point, we see how Beerus turns on over and saying, the geezer had to fall sooner or later. As Whis replies by saying, Roshi did survive quite a while, but I dare say he left behind something far greater. Observe something about Son Goku has changed. And Beerus is like, what? What are you talking about? Making the insinuation that, of course, Master Roshi did leave something behind. And that was a lesson that Goku needed to learn. And Jiren looks on over at Goku and saying, Son Goku, your master still has lessons left to teach you. You're that inexperienced? A man like yourself will never be perfected. And Goku's like, perfected? I don't want that, because that would mean stopping, standing in place while I'm always aiming higher. And Jiren begins to casually walk by as Goku says, and my master's as good of a teacher as ever. And Jiren doesn't care. He sticks his right hand out, he blows Goku back, and Goku's just flying, rolling around in the dirt. He stands back up, he's on his knees, and everyone knows that this is it. Jiren comes up behind him, and Goku goes on to state, I was the worst apprentice who never listened, but it's thanks to that old man that I got stronger. Even so now, I'm Son Goku. Son Goku of the Turtle School. And just before Jiren can knock the head off of Goku, we see how Goku obtains Ultra Instinct. Jiren completely misses, he smashes on down into the ground, he looks on over, and there we have it. Ultra Instinct Omen Goku, and it was not caused based on physical damage having to be applied, but of course it was Master Roshi's wisdom that allowed Goku to become Ultra Instinct, which again is a little weird. But we see how Krillin goes on to state Goku vanished, and Jiren looks on over and saying, you, what is that? And Goku seems to be glowing. Beerus is having a heart attack and saying that move just now, was it really? And Whis is like, it seems so. And Krillin's like, hey, what's so special about what you guys are talking about? And Whis is like, the ultimate technique, which serves the link between consciousness and body, allowing one to dodge any attack subconsciously. Ultra Instinct. And Krillin's like, Ultra Instinct? As Goku looks behind him, buried out of the Ultra Instinct Omen form, and Jiren's like, so, you overcame your wall and arrived at this state? And Goku's like, probably. Vegeta looks on over and he's like, wait now, did they just say Ultra Instinct? And Jiren says, is this the state that you will meet your end? Nothing left on the table, right? And Goku's like, yeah, right. Time to settle this. As Krillin looks on over and saying those two are putting all they have on the line, and Beerus is like, that jerk Goku pulled off Ultra Instinct before me. He's really mad because he knows that Goku had done it. And Shin's like, please, 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 Son Goku, please. Goku gets in position. Jiren gets in position. We see them both charging at each other, which again, you have to give credit where credit is due. The art designs for all of these scans look absolutely amazing. Goku goes in for the punch. Jiren goes in for the punch, and then as quickly as it came, Ultra Instinct vanished. Jiren punches this man so hard in the face, he goes flying out in the distance, crashing through rocks. Goku lands on the floor, he's gasping, and Krillin's like, what just happened? As Whis goes on to state, sadly, it seems that wasn't true Ultra Instinct. It's not a technique that's mastered so easily. Son Goku merely found a chance to tap into it, but nothing more. His struggle has only just begun, and Goku's huffing and puffing, making the insinuation that, of course, what we just saw wasn't true Ultra Instinct. But at the very end, Jiren walks on over and saying, know this, a man of such little resolve will never trump over me, as the manga chapter comes to a close. Now, personally for me, it's very wacky to see how Roshi was able to dodge, and it's not like Roshi was relative to Ultra Instinct, even though it's a very similar technique, it's not exactly the same. So no, Roshi does not have Ultra Instinct. But as for Kefla and Gohan, the reason why Gohan was the way he was because he kept improving on his human side and using that more so than his Saiyan side. Which to me doesn't make sense, but then again, it has been confirmed long ago that half-breeds do possess more potential than pure-blooded Saiyans. And to some, the manga may seem a bit off, but it's all about technique for Roshi, and for Gohan, it looks like he was more or less adapting differently, and I feel like this was one of the most confusing manga chapters in all of Dragon Ball Super. However, to an extent, it did make sense in Roshi having to teach Goku the ways of dodging and evolving. The only thing I personally hated was seeing how Ultra Instinct Omen basically appeared for less than 5 seconds, for less than 3 pages, in not doing anything at all. And we know that Mastered UI is referred to as true Ultra Instinct, but the way Goku went into it was very, very stupid. I did not like the way Goku went into UI Omen because, unlike what we saw in the anime, it was a point of having to take severe body trauma and then having to tap into a state of subconsciousness. Here, Goku mainly tapped into UI just based on the message that Roshi had left behind. So, in the end, I would like to get your thoughts and opinions down in the comment section below. How did you guys personally feel about this? Did you guys like this idea? Did you guys hate this idea? What are your thoughts on Gohan versus Kefla? What are your thoughts as to what is to come in the next manga chapter? Let me know what you all think in the comment section below. Tune back in for more if you guys are new. Punch that subscribe button, leave a like down below, and I'll be seeing each and every single one of you guys in the next Dragon Ball video. Take it easy, everybody. Cue my legendary outro, bitch.